How are you, everyone? Is everything okay? I'm doing well, and I hope you are too. My name is Marcio, and you are on the Família de Yauh channel. Thanks for tuning in, and today we continue our scientific outreach journey in a podcast format. We are going to talk about a very well done and important scientific study due to the results it shows and that you will enjoy learning about in a fun and informative way. A quick summary. We will analyze the trade-off of the chemical modification N1 methyl pseudouridine, or just M1, that made the COVID-19 vaccines so efficient. Could it be that by silencing our body's initial alarm to ensure an immune response, we might be compromising our surveillance against other threats like cancer? It is with special thanks to Dr. Mikolaj Resk from Merogenomics Canada, who provides us with his research article, that we were able to bring you this analysis. Check out and subscribe to his channel, Merogenomics, which has many complete analyses on this topic related to COVID-19. And also, of course, like this video now, so you don't forget. Hit the bell to get more notifications about videos like this and subscribe to the Família de Yauh channel. And folks, she's back. Our AI-generated cyborg guest returns to the Família de Yauh channel to delve into one of the most critical scientific debates of our time. After her first appearance, which you can check out in the card up here, where we discussed post-spike syndrome and the brain fog caused by spike protein, we now dive into this research that raises an alarm about messenger RNA technology. Without further ado, let's get to the interview with her.
Okay, let's unpack this. We're doing a deep dive today into something called N1-methylpseudouridine, or M1. This is that key chemical tweak they used in the COVID-19 mRNA vaccines. Made them work fast, right?
Absolutely. M1 now was, well, it was brilliant for rapid deployment. It solved two huge problems at once. First, it really ramped up the amount of spike protein the body made, which you need for good immune response. And secondly, crucially, it damped the body's own sort of immediate alarm system against foreign RNA.
Ah, right. Without that dampening, the body would just chew up the mRNA before it could even work.
Exactly. It would have been destroyed too quickly. So M1 now was essential for effectiveness.
Okay, so it let the vaccine do its job. But here's the core question from the research we looked at. Does turning down that alarm system maybe compromise our long-term immune surveillance? You know, the kind that fights other things?
That's the potential trade-off, yeah. Yeah. The concern is about those long-term defenses, particularly against things like cancer. The specific mechanism involves how this modification, especially when it's used across the board like 100% modification, it seems to impair the early interferon signaling pathways. Think of interferons as the body's like first responders.
Yeah. And these specific pathways, RIGI and the toll-like receptors, TLRS, I've heard of those in relation to, well, cancer immunity.
You have. They are known players in any tumor responses. So muffling them, even temporarily, could be an issue.
Okay. So how did they test this?
Well, the evidence presented in the sources comes from a marine melanoma model, B16 OVA, I believe. They directly compared vaccines with non-modified mRNA to ones with the 100% M1 modified mRNA.
And the difference was?
Significant.
Significant, yeah.
Pretty stark, actually. The non-modified mRNA vaccines, they triggered a strong anti-tumor response. In those mice, you saw much less tumor growth. Better survival, actually. 100% survived the 31-day experiment and less spread to the lungs.
Okay. Wow. And the group that got the 100% modified mRNA, the kind used in the pandemic vaccines?
They saw basically the opposite effect. Increased tumor growth, more metastasis, and survival dropped significantly. Only about half of those animals made it through the same 31 days.
Half.
Right.
That's quite a contrast. So why does dampening those TLR pathways hit tumor fighting so hard?
It looks linked to the macrophage polarization. Macrophages are immune cells, right? They can be fighters or helpers for tumors. Suppressing TLR signaling seems to stop them from shifting into the anti-tumor M1 mode. Instead, it kind of favors the M2 phenotype. And those M2s can actually help tumors grow and spread.
Okay, so that's the main immune trade-off. But the research mentioned other potential issues with the 100% modification too, didn't it?
It did. Several secondary concerns were raised. One is about translation errors. The M1 modification seems to dramatically increase something called +1 ribosomal frame shifting. Basically, the cell's machinery misreads the instructions, potentially creating weird off-target proteins, new antigens maybe.
And those could theoretically trigger autoimmunity or maybe even stimulate cancer.
That's the concern, yes. Another point was the persistence of modified mRNA.
Right? It hangs around for a long time.
Seems like it. Up to, 187 days in some studies, and, 709 days in other studies. This long-term antigen production might lead to high levels of specific antibody type, IgG4. And high IgG4 is sometimes associated with immune tolerance. The body learning to ignore something rather than active protection.
Tolerance is not what you want against tumors?
Generally, no. And finally, there's the issue of genomic stability. The modified mRNA seems to promote the formation of these structures called G4 quadruplexes and R loops. These are like knots in the genetic material, and they are linked to potential instability in the genome.
Okay, so pulling this all together.
Yeah.
What's the main takeaway for you, the listener, from this research?
Well, it's really important to be clear. The evidence reviewed here doesn't suggest these vaccines cause cancer to start. That's not what the data indicates, but it does raise a serious question about whether they could potentially accelerate the progression of existing cancers, or perhaps reactivate dormant issues. This seems linked to that temporary immune suppression needed for the vaccine to work initially.
And based on these findings, particularly the mouse model, the researchers make a pretty strong recommendation, right?
They do. They suggest moving away from 100% M1 modification in clinical trials. And they even propose a pause, a moratorium on using these fully modified vaccines in people until we have long-term studies that can really confirm or deny this potential cancer promotion risks.
Which leads us to a really challenging final thought for you to consider. Given how successful this mRNA tech was against an acute threat like COVID-19, what's the right balance here?
Exactly. How do we weigh maximizing that immediate short-term vaccine punch against preserving the robustness of our long-term day-to-day immune surveillance that protects against other threats like cancer?
Finding that balance, that's going to be critical as this technology moves forward. Something definitely to think about.
Now, to conclude this conversation with an illustration of the topic we covered in this deep dive, let's briefly analyze the following images from the article, so that you, our science-loving audience, can better understand the effects that the pseudouridine present in these mRNA-based products can cause in living organisms. Here it is. Let's just look at a few very striking images from this study. One of them, however, I unfortunately had to blur due to YouTube's community policies, okay? So as not to harm the video and consequently the scientific outreach. Here. In figure 1, we have a complete diagram of the schematic representation of the potential effects of 100% M1 pseudouridine modified mRNA vaccines on RIG1-like receptors, the RLRs. The suppression of RLR function can induce the desired evasion of immune detection to ensure that the vaccine's genetic content is successfully translated into an immunogenic antigen. But the suppressive pathways are also known to play important roles in cancer development surveillance, potentially triggering unwanted non-specific effects. In figure 2 of the article, it's observed that immunization with unmodified mRNA LNP prevents lung metastasis of B16F10 OVA melanoma. In contrast, the modified OVA LNP with 100% M1 pseudouridine showed no suppression of lung metastasis with the same number of lung nodules as the unrelated antigen, that is PR8HALNP or the PBS control. As this is a review article, this figure is from an open access article distributed under the terms of the Creative Commons Attribution CC BY license. In figure 6 shows a diagram of some pathways that the mRNA molecule with synthetic pseudouridine leads the organism to take. The evasion of immune detection by a 100% M1 modified mRNA causes the desired increased immunogenicity. But it may also cause additional subsequent effect that could inadvertently be contributing to the unwanted stimulation of cancer growth and metastasis in affected individuals, whether in the early stages of cancer development or in those already receiving cancer treatment. In figure 7, the one with the lab mice, which is intentionally blurred here, we can, despite the blur, still discern organs that were examined during a necropsy after spontaneous death, which revealed lymphoid neoplasia 2 days after the booster vaccination with BNT162B2. In figure A, at necropsy, Several of the animal's primary organs, including the liver, kidneys, spleen, and intestines, as you see in black arrows, showed a disproportionate hypertrophy. A reference animal with typical morphology is in figure B. This figure is from an open access article distributed under the terms of the Creative Commons Attribution CC BY license. So that's it. Bye bye, everyone.